Welcome to the 25th Annual Edith Fox King Lecture, sponsored by the Department of Journalism Photography and the Campus Chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists. As I said, this is our 25th lecture. It began in 1978 with a shocking story told by Joe Murray, the editor of the Lufkin News, who had discovered that a young man who had been killed in boot camp had been beaten to death. His family came to place an obituary. Joe decided, well, maybe I'd better look into this, and wound up winning the Pulitzer that year for his coverage and exposing tactics in boot camp that resulted in changes in the Marine boot camp. After that, we have had 18 other Pulitzer winners over the years. So our speaker today is the 20th. For those of you who may not be familiar with the Pulitzer Prize, it's the top award in journalism. It's given to reporters, editors, cartoonists, photographers. And over the years, we've had two photographers who were our very own. One, Ron Cortez with the Philadelphia Inquirer, took his first photography course with Mr. Jerry Townsend in a night class. And then the latest of our Pulitzer winners was Rodolfo Gonzalez, who won the Pulitzer for his coverage of Columbine for the Rocky Mountain News. Also, for those of you not familiar with Edith Fox King, she was a wonderful woman. I knew Edith in the 60s. I would say that if you could describe her descriptively, you would say that she had a voice like a contralto foghorn. She was a cheerleader in college at the University of Texas and remained a cheerleader over the years for journalism and journalism education. Our speaker today is the travel editor of the Wall Street Journal and the Journal's deputy bureau chief in Dallas. He's also a weekly columnist for WSJ.com, and I overheard him this morning saying that they have a circulation of 600,000, which is unheard of for internet publications. He's been on the airline beat for 8 years, long enough to see it go from bust to boom and back to bust. And I will say that Scott is unique for us in that he's the first speaker who flew in his own airplane. So we met him at the airport yesterday and made a great issue of it, taking pictures and having a lot of fun. He's a native of Boston, and how he got to the South to Duke University, I'll never know. But he's a graduate of Duke University and was editor of his university newspaper. He spent 11 years with the Associated Press before joining the Journal. He's the author of 3 books. And as I said, he's an instrument-rated, multi-engine, private pilot who lives in Dallas. Before last year, our lectures were in the evening, and at that time we recognized students in the journalism photography department who had won awards. And so since we haven't been able to do that, I'd like to just tell you a little bit about our awards from last year. Last year, The Ranger and The Forthright were selected Best Newspaper and Best Magazine in Region 8 of the Society of Professional Journalists, which includes 4-year universities. And we had 2 students who were recognized as the best columnist in Region 8 and the best editorial cartoonist. This year in Texas Community College Journalism Awards, we won 23 awards, including the sweepstakes, best newspaper, and best magazine. So we're very proud of our students. And if any of you decide you'd like to win awards, come join us. Let me present now our speaker, Scott McCartney.
Thanks, Chet. You mentioned Joe Murray, and the reporter on that story with Joe Murray was Phil and Ken Herman, who I worked with for many years at the Associated Press. And Ken was the source of one of my favorite stories in journalism, where he was traveling with the governor in a small airplane, and I think it was the governor and the Speaker of the House and maybe one other, and they went through incredible rough weather, and all were convinced they were going to crash. It was very tense until Ken said, "I can just see the headline now, Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter, three others killed in crash." It's great to be here with you today, and it's really an honor to be representing the entire staff of the Wall Street Journal. I'm going to talk about a Pulitzer Prize that was not won by me, or by a handful of reporters, or by a team of editors and writers. This award for breaking news was really awarded to the entire staff, and that really means everyone from delivery drivers to computer technicians, especially computer technicians, and the managing editor, who was here dead much of the day on December 11th. That day was as horrible a day as modern times can muster, I think. There were 3,000 people killed, multitudes were injured, 100,000 left homeless, businesses were destroyed, and the nation was temporarily paralyzed. And it all happened right across the street from the Wall Street Journal. In some ways, you'd think that would be an advantage to cover the news. After all, I spent more than 10 years at DHB running two news events, flying off the disaster scenes, trying to scramble to get inside police lines and close to the action. On September 11th, the news literally came to our front door. Wall Street Journal's headquarters, it's our main office with about 800 employees, was catty-corner across the street from the World Trade Center. That proved to be a huge disadvantage to us. Like war correspondents caught underneath the bombing raid, we became part of the disaster. At about 9:15, less than 30 minutes after the first plane struck the tower, and only a couple minutes after the second plane hit, we had to evacuate our building. Nobody took much with them. They actually thought that they'd be back that afternoon. A good friend of mine had very expensive tickets to the producer's Broadway show on his desk. He kind of looked at him as the alarms were going off and it was time to leave, and he really thought he'd be back, so he just left the tickets there. He didn't get back. Many of these folks had been through the World Trade Center bombing in 1993, and so they sort of assumed that it was going to be much the same drill. But then as both buildings came tumbling down, the neighborhood was quite literally destroyed. Our people went from being reporters to victims. There were harrowing escapes through smoke and rubble as bodies fell and buildings disappeared. Amid all that chaos and fear, they instinctively went to work. Reporters went about gathering information. Editors had to get to a computer anywhere. Some set out for a Dow Jones back office in southern New Jersey, about 50 miles south of Manhattan, figuring that was the closest Wall Street Journal facility that could be used. Many of them didn't have any choice about New Jersey because ferries that come in behind our building were evacuating people off the island to New Jersey, and they were going there whether they wanted to or not. Others who hadn't gotten to work yet that morning ended up congregating in different apartments around the city. And word kind of spread through cell phones, email and things. Barney and Dan were here, Jim and Larry were there. Missing throughout it all was Paul Steiger, our longtime, much-loved managing editor. Paul was one of the last people to leave the building. And he last told a group of colleagues that he was setting off to find his wife, who worked nearby. Shortly after he headed off on his own at about 10 a.m., the South Tower, which is the closest one to our building, collapsed. I run the paper's airline and aviation coverage, so my cell phone started ringing on the first report that a small plane had flown into the World Trade Center. Chet said, "I'm a pilot myself," and it didn't make any sense to me. As soon as you see the picture, and it's a perfectly clear day, why any sort of plane would run into a building like that. I was in Seattle to cover a meeting of air traffic control technology specialists looking for ways to reduce travel delays. That was the big story that you may recall. It was 5:46 a.m. in Seattle when the first plane struck. I'd been headed for the shower, but never made it when the phone started ringing. Those of us outside New York had access to phones and emails that people inside didn't have. We quickly realized that we could be alone on this story. There was no contact for hours with many of our folks in Manhattan. We had no idea whether we had lost colleagues. We had no idea whether we'd even be publishing a newspaper the next day. That was great jeopardy. On TV, I could sometimes see my work home in the rubble. It was really quite terrifying. The elevated footbridge I took many times from the hotel at the World Trade Center to our offices figured prominently in news pictures. I knew that among the dust-covered survivors you could see were probably some of my friends and colleagues. The last thing that Paul did before he left the building was to put the Washington Bureau in charge. Some of us didn't even know that, but Alan Murray, who was in our Washington Bureau chief, kind of acted as a de facto managing editor. Other bureau chiefs began assembling story ideas just on the assumption that we might have a newspaper. Karen Blumenthal, our Dallas bureau chief, put together an early version of our news skit, the list of stories that we think we'll be publishing the next day, and set that around, and that really kind of got the ball rolling on the next day's paper. In South Brunswick, New Jersey, which is where we had this back office facility, computer technicians took a pot of computers that had been set up for training on a new editing system we were just switching to, and were able to reprogram that into a live editing system. By about 5 p.m., we had an editing and graphics course in that basement training room to about 40 people. That's really only a fraction of the normal course, but it was all we had. Email was one of the few ways we had to communicate. The backup generators in our evacuated building actually kept working, even though there was no electricity or anything else. And that kept the email network running for several days. Reporters had no idea where or how to file material, since the basic news system that we used was non-existent. So they started emailing things around. And they just kind of emailed to all the likely suspects. National news editor Marcus Brockley, who was in his apartment in Brooklyn, ended up fielding 1,000 emails just from the reporting staff on September 11th. Breaking news isn't necessarily our forte at the Wall Street Journal. We don't have a city desk. Many of our folks haven't covered hurricanes and earthquakes and riots, as I did at the AP. We don't have great sources in the police department or the mayor's office or the FBI. Business news is really kind of a 9-to-5 affair. We only publish 5 days a week. But what we did have going for us that day was deep-rooted beat coverage in several of the key industries involved in the attacks, namely airlines and financial institutions. My part of the coverage focused on talking to contacts inside American, United, the Federal Aviation Administration, various airports, including Boston's Logan Airport, which was kind of key. We talked to airline pilots about the training and instructions they received. The line before September 11th, you may recall, was that they should cooperate with hijackers no matter what. One of the important lessons of that day, I think, is that beat reporting, I believe, is more important than ever in journalism. It's a tendency in this business to bounce from one subject to the next. Reporters are asked to know a little about a lot of things. That day, the Wall Street Journal drew mightily on extensive knowledge of the beats we covered. We divided the world by industry, not by geography, so that our reporters will be the prime expert in the field they're covering. We want specialists, not generalists. We tend to stay on beats a long time because we want our people to be analysts and historians as well as reporters. And so in aviation, we immediately drew on that extensive knowledge of airline procedures and security shortcomings, something we had written a lot about before September 11th. We knew what airline crews had at their disposal on board planes, a little more than silly plastic handcuffs to restrain drunk passengers. We knew the cockpit doors are flimsy and easily breached, and they have breakaway panels that offer a little protection. Airport security, we had a pretty good basis in the shortcomings there. We knew that the General Accounting Office had issued a report less than a year before September 11th. When we went back and looked at it, it had some pretty chilling things to say that proved quite telling. We knew that the attackers had knives, box cutters, and other weapons from the cell phone calls that came from the plane. We didn't know how they got them through, and we said that, but we knew that there were frequent failures in the system. We knew that security functions at airports were done by low bidders working for airlines, and that security screeners were paid less at some airports than fast food workers in the terminals nearby. We knew that security recommendations made after both the Gulf War and the TWA 800 disaster had not yet been done. And we learned that day that the FAA had actually planned to issue new, tighter security rules later in September. From our reporting that first day, we even laid out likely security enhancements from individual searches of passengers, as we were now, to matching baggage to passengers and deploying bomb scanning machines. It's all pretty much happening as we predicted it that first day. Our story was singled out as being, quote, extraordinarily sophisticated for a first day story, but it was far from the only one. The 10 stories that made up our Pulitzer package all reflected that. In addition to intimate and terrifying portraits of the day, including two amazing first-hand accounts, we immediately gauged the impact on markets, on the economy, on banks, on the phone system, on media, interestingly, and on the psyche of the city and the nation. We wrote about how civil liberties would likely be reduced, how security would be tightened. We looked at the impact on individual companies. We even published a list of World Trade Center tenants with floor numbers all on that first day. We made one huge mistake right on top of deadlines. We had very early deadlines that day, since we didn't know what difficulty trucks would have delivering papers, or whether we'd be able to fly papers as we do to remote places every day, or whether we could count on the U.S. mail, which still delivers a good chunk of our circulation. That mistake was that someone sent out a request to let the company know where you are and whether you were safe. Seems simple enough, except that the email was sent company-wide, which really includes thousands of people. And as people started responding, they hit reply to all instead of just reply to the sender. Well, that generated thousands and thousands of emails. And just about crashed the email system right on deadline. System slowed to a crawl. Some messages didn't get to me for 4 hours. I was talking to the Boston bureau chief about the aviation story, and he said, "Didn't you get my fix?" And I said, "No," and we realized what had happened, and so we immediately started resorting to dictation. Throughout the day, one of the burning pits in the stomach for many of us was, "Where's Paul?" Paul Steiger hadn't been heard from for hours. Concern was rampant that he had been beside the towers as they fell and didn't survive. As poor as communications were, word spread quickly, and many conversations or emails began with, "Have you heard anything about Paul?" Late in the day, the phone rang at the apartment of Assistant Managing Editor Barney Culane, where several senior editors had gathered. "Barney, this is Paul," the voice said. "Paul who?" Barney asked. "Paul Steiger." "Is this Paul Steiger?" "Yes, Barney, it's Paul Steiger." Barney dropped the receiver and burst into tears. And then as soon as they recovered, Paul dictated the double deck banner headline we ran on the front page. In all, what we did that day, and I think for all journalists, under the most difficult circumstances, stands as a model of urgent but responsible breaking news reporting. Reporters did their jobs and did them beautifully that day. The country was desperate for information. We got it to them through television, print, radio, internet. In those first few days, especially the first day, media had a tremendous responsibility to inform but not inflame, to get it right and to do it quickly. And I think that, by and large, the journalistic community very well. It was a time when the country leaned on its institutions, including the media, to sort things out and start recovering. There's no better example of the importance of this wonderful profession. In our case, the fact that we not only got a paper out, but a damn good paper at that, was very important for our readers. In fact, in the hundreds of letters we received in the days that followed, readers thanked us not just for delivering a paper, but for delivering that paper. The bond between reader and reporter was greatly strengthened that day, I think. What we wrote made a difference in their lives. There's no greater reward for a journalist. After deadline on the first day, I curled up on my hotel bed and stared at the TV for about an hour. I was dazed. The shock of what happened really hadn't started to set in. As it did, it became clear that it was time to go back to work for the next day's paper. I started a new round of calls to airline contacts, looking more closely at security, at who the hijackers were, and what happened to all the planes diverted to remote parts of Canada and elsewhere. My wife called. "The kids were upset and needed to talk to you," she said. "We need to hear that you're okay." I found myself trying to reassure my 11-year-old, "It'll be okay. They'll catch you, Dad. They'll make it safe to fly again." "Oh, no, Dad," she said very matter-of-factly. "I'm never going to get on an airplane again." It wasn't until late that night, well past midnight in Texas that I talked to some of my closest contacts in America. They'd been in their crisis command center, and some had been sent home to sleep so they'd be ready for the next day. They couldn't sleep, so I got to talk to some of them. Spent a lot of time in America's operations center over the years on various stories. It's a room about the size of a football field filled with experts in all the areas it takes to run an airline, the scheduling, dispatch, air traffic control, catering, you name it. When the FAA was having real difficulty managing the nation's air traffic system a couple of years before September 11, American let me spend days in the operations center watching chaos unfold. I've done stories on how airlines recover from blizzards, hurricanes, how airlines decide which flight to cancel, and all the many functions that go on behind the scenes that passengers never see. That coverage proved incredibly valuable as part of my beat coverage on September 11th. And I knew that night that there was probably an incredible story to tell of what had happened in the operations center at American and United that day. But I also knew that it would take a long time before those guys could talk about it. Through the first night, stories for the next day took shape. Second day was much easier because we knew that everyone had survived, and we had better temporary quarters set up in New Jersey. Vans were sent to collect editors in blocks of hotel rooms for work. I think it was September 12th that the company ordered about $1 million worth of Dell computers so that we could rebuild a reporting and editing system, since airplanes weren't flying and the equipment was trucked from Austin to New Jersey. It was a good 48 hours, maybe more, I've really forgotten, before I even crossed the threshold of my hotel room door. The hotel brought me newspapers and an occasional meal and kept the phone lines clear for me. Reporting was almost constant. It was really just interrupted a couple hours each day by writing. We had people working the airline story in Chicago, Dallas, Atlanta, Washington, Boston, Los Angeles, Canada, and Europe. Right away, it was clear that the airline industry would be financially devastated. We said that. The plane was driven home when American told us that it planned to cut 20% of their schedule once flying to Zoom. The airline didn't say it that day, but it was clear to us that 20% meant thousands of layoffs and a huge restructuring for a fragile industry. Our work over the next several weeks brought lots of scoops. One that I was particularly proud of retraced the history of why the FAA allowed knives on board airplanes in the first place and showed how the box cutters used by the hijackers were in fact legal to be carried on board. We did significant work on the passenger profiling system and its significant shortcomings. Despite the lack of coordination with law enforcement, the system actually picked out several of the hijackers for security scrutiny. The security scrutiny then meant simply that their checked luggage had to be searched, and some of their checked bags didn't even make the connection to Boston. The story I'm most proud of, beyond the first day's coverage, is the story of the operations center. After a few weeks had passed, I asked American to let me come talk to the folks on duty that day. My colleague in Chicago, Susan Carey, made the same request of United. I told them that I knew that there had to be an incredible story to tell there, and there was, American said, after talking with everyone involved, including the CEOs, who talked to each other and decided that they could trust us to get it right. Both airlines agreed. It was the hardest reporting we had ever done emotionally. For Susan, some of the folks at United broke down in tears as they walked her through the crisis. There was one dispatcher who had been handling both hijacked planes at United. In painful detail, he recounted to her the horrible nightmares he had been having since that day. Both airlines told us of the confusion that they fought through over which plane was which. American was convinced that both of its planes had gone into the World Trade Center in New York, and a United plane must have crashed into the Pentagon. American Chief Executive Donald Carty recounted to me how he asked the Secretary of Transportation to resolve the confusion. For God's sakes, it's in the Pentagon. Can't somebody go look at it? Carty asked Norman Mineta, who was in the secret bunker with Vice President Dick Cheney. They have, Mr. Mineta told him. You can't tell. One of my longtime acquaintances at American's Operations Center is a fellow named Craig Marquis, who's a manager on duty, MOD. The main crisis manager there, the decision maker at the operations center. He's kind of Oz behind the curtain. In a previous story, we had taken his picture and created a dot drawing of Craig to run with the story. In the business world, the Wall Street Journal dot drawings are quite a big deal. I didn't realize quite how big until executives started saying, you know, I really want my dot He jokingly complained that there was no picture of him. And I promised that the next time he was in the Wall Street Journal, half sort of thinking that there probably never would be a next time in the Wall Street Journal, I'd make sure his picture got in. And Craig was MOD on September 11th. We talked at length about what he went through. He'd been able to talk to one of the flight attendants on board Flight 11, the first plane that hijacked. He'd been listening as the plane crashed into the World Trade Center and the line went dead. Like so many others, he'd been watching the radar flip of Flight 11, which had been isolated on this huge screen in the command center. And then watch it turn south and head down the Hudson River toward the tip of Manhattan, and then with the next radar sweep, it just disappeared. At the end of the interview, Craig reminded me of my promise of a dock run. You got it, I assured him. We said goodbye, I got into my car, and I slumped over and started sobbing. That was a Friday afternoon in October. We had actually heard that the New York Times was trying to interview the United dispatcher who had handled both flights, and United was actually stalling the Times because we had asked first. But we knew that we had to work quickly, it wouldn't last long. Susan filed memos to me, and I wrote like crazy Friday night, all day Saturday. I gave the story to my wife, who also happens to be my editor, on Saturday night. It has its conveniences. Because of the rush, we hadn't made arrangements in advance for extra space. We didn't really know if we could really deliver from Monday's paper. So instead of the 100 inches that we'd get with a clean page that we could have reserved in advance, the best we could get was only about 70 inches. I turned in a story that was at least 80 inches, along with a detailed timeline and pictures of all the principles for dock runs, putting effect on key. And then late Saturday afternoon, the journal had a really tough choice. We either had to cut about 30 inches from the story or cut the art. And the paper made, maybe kind of blasphemy in the visual arts center to say this, but made sort of a unique decision, I think, in journalism, where they decided the words were more important than the pictures. So we filled that 70-inch hole with no graphics or pictures. Craig Marquis' dock drawing got pulled again. That story, which is called Flying Blind, prompted a huge outpouring from readers. Once again, it brought us closer to our readers. I think in an age of instant messaging and mass communication, live TV, and internet chat, September 11th reminds us that stories still matter, that newspapers matter, and that the bonds between journalist and reader are more important than ever. It's hard to take any joy from what happened on September 11th, but I think journalism can take great pride in the job that we all did and in the appreciation that our readers showed. So, thanks for listening, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Has your daughter flown since then?
Yeah, she did. We actually flew to Boston at Christmas. And in Boston, she got singled out as a selectee in the security. She was incredibly nervous about flying. And there we are going through security, and they picked her. And they took her backpack and opened up all the pencil cases and things. And
having all that security centered on her, reassure her at all that they were really doing something about security?
I think it just raised her anxiety. Certainly raised my anxiety. I was more worried if they were focused on her, who were they missing? And in fact, I had, my wife has a different last name, so I and the two kids have the same last name, and they kind of selected us as a group. They're really going through Jenny's stuff. But I had taken a bag that I was carrying and handed it to my wife and said, here, take this on board. We got to go through the security thing. And then it occurred to me that there could be, you know, people behind who would have freaked out when they saw that. And I was giving away a bag to avoid going through security.
That's what you want to do.
Yeah. Yeah. It was devastating. I mean, Danny was very well known and much loved. And, he's a really neat guy. And it was, I mean, all in all, it was an incredibly tough year for the paper. We had actually, in January of 2001, a colleague of mine on the aviation fleet was killed in a plane crash. The Washington Bureau lost a reporter who had covered Three Mile Island. Died of lingering effects of radiation exposure. He had died that year. Then we had September 11th, and then all within a 12-month period, Danny was kidnapped. And so it was just awful. I say everyone survived on September 11th. We actually, one of our senior editors very nearly died in the weeks that followed. When he had ingested a tremendous amount of dust, I think, and had his body had a horrible reaction to it. He was in intensive care for about 4 weeks. He had, I think, 20-something different surgeries. It's really awful. You know, we just felt kind of jinxed. But Danny's kidnapping and murdering was, it really was incredibly painful. He actually covered transportation early in his career. He was the Washington guy there. And so I knew him a little bit. My wife knew him better because he had been in the Middle East, and so he had been more involved in our oil coverage. And we had lots of mutual friends.
How do you feel about airport security as it stands today?
I think it's a lot better, believe it or not. I think they're still working through a lot of the hassles, but I think they'll get there. And I think the really major security improvement comes in April, when airlines are required to have bulletproof, bomb-proof doors on the cockpit. And when we get to that, I think we're kind of there on security, because if you can't get into the cockpit, we're back to the old threats before September 11th, where we really ought to be focused on bombs and baby guns or whatever. But you're not going to be able to hijack an airplane with a knife, and that's that is a big security improvement. So once we get those doors in place, I'd like to see some of the security hassles kind of loosened up, and the recognition that maybe you can destroy an airplane with a bomb, but that's not what these guys were after, or what the big problem was. The big problem is using the airplane as a guided missile. I think there probably are. It's hard to say, because we really don't know what the warnings are based on, how credible it is. But I think the government's kind of gotten into this mode where Well, if we just put out a warning, we've covered ourselves. And if you put out too many warnings, then people stop paying attention to them. Yeah, I think so, unless the government's got to be a little more aggressive about deciding if this is real or not real. And I think, by and large, people are pretty much still on alert. And when you put out a totally unspecific warning saying, well, something could happen, what do we know that we didn't know?
Since you put much of September 11th and you concentrated on that when you first started, has anything changed? Have you kind of went away from that and started and went back to what you used to cover in the Wall Street Journal, or has it just continued on in depth?
It's just continued on. Everything changed. On the airline beat, the entire industry changed. I mean, we were writing stories before about record profits and, travel was starting to slow down a little bit, but everybody was worried about delays. There were too many planes in the sky and the FAA couldn't handle it and all that. Now, that completely changed on September 11th, and all of a sudden we're writing about bankruptcy, which we had never written about. And that's continued for that industry. All the security hassles and things like that have really poor coverage for us. And I think that's been true on many, many beats. Some have, the economy has affected it to a great deal, and so if you're covering technology or you're covering retail or whatever, the lingering effects of September 11th still play into your coverage a whole lot. We have gone back, that fall for the first